Today we have with us an expert on Moldova, Vladislav Kulminski, who is the executive director of Chisinau-based Institute for Strategic Initiatives. So thanks for taking time to speak to us about this very important topic about what's going on in Moldova. So the first question is, after having total control of all institutions in Moldova since 2016, why do you think Vladimir Plahotniuc just agreed to leave now? Can we actually draw parallels with Viktor Yanukovych's departure from Ukraine in 2014?
You could argue that, but one thing that I think is different about Moldova is that Mr. Plahotniuc has never really had support from important segments of the population in the Republic of Moldova. His control over the country was based largely on bribes, on control over the law enforcement agencies, on corruption. And pretty much what he has created here in the Republic of Moldova was a gray zone between the East and the West, which he ran as his personal fiefdom. So this was not exactly a model of a state that could be viable here in this part of Europe. So the only question was, when is the system going to collapse, rather than whether it is going to collapse? And, you know, the way, because of the way that it collapsed in the way that it did, today Moldova has a new chance, a new window of opportunity, a new beginning, if you wish.
Okay, thanks. And do we actually know where Plahotniuc went? Because there were there's information about him going to the UK via Ukraine, but his family lives in Switzerland. Can we already talk of an exile? And will we actually see more of him and his allies?
No, I think it's basically a flight. So he pretty much abandoned this entire structure that he has created in the Republic of Moldova, which is largely aimed to extract illegal revenue. And we basically can argue that this is a state Ponzi scheme, which is going to collapse and which is already collapsing once you remove the key pillar, the key foundation of the system, which is Mr. Plahotniuc. And, you know, this time around, this was a very interesting occurrence of events. You have pro-Russian and pro-European party, which united against Mr. Plahotniuc, even though they have very serious ideological and geopolitical differences. They nevertheless thought that it is important to first give Moldova an opportunity to develop internally, to develop domestically, to have an economy that is open to the people, that works for the people, to have human rights and to have such like things, and a functional public administration, you know, which basically would give Moldova a new start. And much like this, the United States of America, Russia, and the European Union agreed that, you know, it was not about geopolitical differences, but it was about a deeply corrupt, deeply dysfunctional system that Mr. Plahotniuc has built and which could actually draw all the states into a confrontation with each other. So there was consensus that it would be better for Mr. Plahotniuc to go rather than have, you know, a hot spot of instability in this crucial part of Europe. And I would sort of, you know, immediately remind you that there's Russian military presence in Transnistria. You know, there's neighboring Ukraine, there's neighboring Romania. So this kind of, you know, geopolitical repercussions could be dire. And everybody wanted to avoid an unnecessary confrontation over Mr. Plahotniuc, much as he tried to pit everybody against each other here. Where did he go? He has left Moldova, and there are conflicting, and there's conflicting information where he might be right now. Some people say he went first to Odessa through the Transnistrian region, which seems to be a plausible answer because he has not been registered as a person who has left or who has crossed Moldova's national border. Let me remind you that if you leave Moldova through Transnistria, then, you know, your name does not get registered in the list of people who cross Moldova's national border, because there is no kind of, you know, so the only way you will get registered is once you enter Ukraine, but nobody registers you once you leave Moldova through the Transnistrian region. And then people say that from Odessa, he flew somewhere in Europe and then to the United States of America. There are rumors that his family is in Miami. And, you know, so that's where he might be right now. But considering that he basically left in a huge hurry, It seems that no international guarantees have been offered to him, which basically means that the incoming Moldovan government is probably going to take a very close look into what happened during his time in office here, and then, depending on the results, would perhaps, you know, start persecuting him internationally.
Okay, and so Plahotniuc only has business in Moldova. Will he still be able to use administrative resource in his interests, or is that the end of Plahotniuc in Moldova?
Most of his money is in the West, in fact. Okay. And you know, in Moldova, yes, he has a lot of property here. Pretty much, he controlled and owned most of government institutions. He owned 97% of the local authorities and regional authorities. So his control over the Republic of Moldova was almost total. But the system is going to start collapsing, and it's already collapsing. So it's really going to be extremely difficult for him to maintain control not being in the Republic of Moldova. And so, you know, hopefully we will see a new beginning for the Republic of Moldova. But one of the problems is that, you know, all incoming Moldovan governments, what they did, they found all these money-making mechanisms at their disposal, which they could use for their own purposes. So what they did, they did not destroy them. They just took them over and continued these corrupt practices. But there's a lot of hope in the Republic of Moldova that this time around, it is going to be really different. And there's, you know, civil society, lots of watchdogs and the rest of population that perhaps would not accept the coming of another Mr. Plahotniuc in office in the Republic of Moldova.
And what do you think actually urged him to go? What was the last drop? Was it pressure from the West, Russia? Do you think he actually made any agreements prior to his departure with anyone?
Look, I think it was a combination of factors because, you know, as the crisis unfolded, as the new Maia Sandu government was voted in, Plahotniuc vowed to take the last stand, to fight to the end. He canceled, you know, the constitutional court, which he controlled, canceled the creation of the government. It removed President Dodon from office. It scheduled early elections. You know, so did, and by the way, they just recently, yesterday, they canceled all these decisions. So undid everything that they did over the whole couple of days from the 7th until the 9th of June. What was the key factor? I think it was a combination of two factors. First, it was a determination on the part of Moldova's new government to go all the way. They said there will be no negotiations with Plahotniuc. We are the legitimate government and we will go all the way. And any civil disturbances, any civil unrest or even bloodshed would be the guilt of Mr. Plahotniuc, because he is the guy who is illegitimate and who refuses to leave. So this determination was very important domestically to go all the way, you know, to run massive street protests if need be. And of course, this determination also in part led to foreign governments exercising pressure to go. You know, these two factors, external pressure on Mr. Plahotniuc and domestic pressure on Mr. Plahotniuc, which also, you know, helped foreign governments to take the right decision. And against the combination of two factors, he couldn't possibly stand. So he made a rational decision, a rational choice to flee the country, because otherwise he would have just become a bloody dictator who would have been branded as such by Russia, the European Union, the United States of America, likely Ukraine and Romania, and, you know, and would face very staunch opposition domestically. So it was a combination of force that he couldn't possibly hope to defeat and to emerge victorious.
And how come Russia's position was actually concurrent with the West in this situation?
Look, I told you, I think that it's basically the idea is that both Russia and the United States understood that Mr. Plahotniuc was not driven by any ideology. So he was saying to Russia that Moldova is going to be part of Russia's sphere of influence. He was telling the United States that, you know, Moldova is going to be part of Western sphere of influence. So he was trying to play them against each other. And he did so in kind of in a very strange way, which risked, you know, kind of confrontation here domestically and could draw Russia and the United States into a confrontation with each other here in the Republic of Moldova. my guess is that, you know, they both wanted to avoid it while there's still, you know, geopolitical confrontation, very serious one going on in the region. There really has to be a reason for why they would clash here. And clashing over Plahotniuc and clashing over maintaining him in office was really not worth it. So it was not about Moldova's geopolitical orientation towards the east or towards the west. It was really a corrupt, completely dysfunctional state and a rule by one person, which he wanted to preserve. And this was, of course, a goal that you could not sell to either Russia or the United States of America. So, you know, they basically agree that, you know, let's just remove this guy. And then, you know, it does not cancel out geopolitical confrontation over the region. It will continue, no question about it. You know, there's Russian military, illegal Russian military presence in Transnistria. There's kind of the Transnistrian conflict that still needs to be resolved and all and everything. All of it remains. But with Plahotniuc no longer in the picture, you know, the risk of a direct clash has lessened significantly.
And can we actually talk of an independent constitutional court now?
No. It's going to be a huge and a very difficult process, you know, of actually getting these institutions back on track. The Constitutional Court is just the pinnacle of a deeply corrupt system. But you also have governments, you also have ministries, you also have the prosecutor's office, which takes completely preposterous and ridiculous decisions on a daily basis. You have the Ministry of Internal Affairs, which is also rather dysfunctional, and you have the entire justice system, which needs to be rebuilt from scratch, where judges, you know, sell their decisions, where those who have more money can buy decisions. And, you know, that is really kind of a very difficult task of reforming a dysfunctional public administration system from scratch. And the Constitutional Court is just a pinnacle, you know, kind of, if you wish, a manifestation of a deeply corrupt system. So there has to be a lot of work that will go into it. There has to be a lot of goodwill, political will, you know, to actually change the system and make it work for the people. Kind of put it at the service of the people, if you wish. Public service assets need to be rebuilt from scratch. It's quite a task.
And how much longer do you think this coalition of ACRM and the Socialist Party will last because of the ideological differences?
I do not expect it to be a very long one. It's probably going to be rather short-lived. So their goal would be to change the election system from mixed back to proportional, ensure conditions for more or less free and fair elections in Moldova, and then announce early elections. Because their basic argument was that, you know, the way this parliament was elected was completely not representational. It did not represent, you know, the Republic of Moldova as it is today. And it was done with the use of administrative resources, that the election was in essence rigged, there were falsifications, etc. So the key goal would be create the conditions for free and fair elections, then go, you know, for early elections, and then after that see what happens. So that's pretty much the goal of the coalition today. But how long is it going to last to actually achieve this task? That's, you know, anybody's guess. It can last anywhere from 6 months to 1 year. And whether they would still be able to maintain their focus on this key goal is, of course, another very difficult question. Whether they would just want to go back to their ideological and geopolitical divisions, in which case, you know, the coalition is going to break down quite rapidly.
And what do you think the future holds for the Democratic Party? Because it was usually viewed as anti-Russian previously, but then there were some reportedly meetings with Russian and a sort of change of position and trying to resolve the Transnistrian conflicts as well. Do you think they will actually get seats in the next parliament?
Look, I mean, they still have 30 seats in this parliament, 30 out of 101 seats in this parliament, which is a lot. It's almost one third of the parliament. What's going to happen to the party in the next election? You know, I think that it's really faces a prospect of not making it to the next parliament. Because most likely it's going to start going under, you know, because now as a lot of crimes of the previous government will be uncovered and published, a lot of very bad stuff is going to be blamed on the Democratic Party. So if you wish, the Democratic Party might actually become a scapegoat for everything that happened in the past. So it's going to be quite tough for them to make it to the parliament, but they still will exercise important influence in this parliament, but without Mr. Plahotniuc and, you know, perhaps five or six other people who were in Plahotniuc's inner circle and who pretty much made Moldova what it is today.